Be wary, citizens. You're about to enter a spoiler zone.
That's right. We're about to talk Civil War spoilers. So if you are just walking into this and you're getting ready to watch or listen to the episode, that's great. We love you. But the truth is, we're about to talk. It's been 3 weeks since the movie started out. And if you haven't seen the movie by now, come back after you watch it and listen to the episode to hear our opinions. But if you don't want to be spoiled, as weird as it sounds, stop where you're at, come back after you see the movie, and then listen to it because we don't want to ruin the movie for you. So on that note, hang on to your capes because you're about to be spoiled by super geeks. All right. I always say all right just before we stop the music. I don't know why. It just sounds right. But anyways, how's everyone doing?
Good.
Doing great.
Doing good.
All right. So there's a lot to talk about tonight. I'm George. Chooch99A is my Twitter. And Anthony, where can we find you?
You can follow me on Twitter at Anthony Battles.
Very good. Very good. What about you, Ross? I mean, sorry, Will.
On Twitter, at Intrinsicus, that's Intrinsic with a U.S. on the end.
And what about you, Ross?
Twitter, SubSailor688.
And John?
John, you can find me at Vanishing Point at www.vanishingpoint.biz.
Speaking of which, I don't know if you saw what I posted on Facebook the other day, but as everybody knows, if you heard previous episodes of that is, I've been working on this Batman graphic novel, and I've been testing out this new engine, John. John got me to update my dad's studio, which is the program we talked about that a lot of people use. And one of his models is a soldier that I use in it, who's the main character of my comic. It's a sort of found footage, sort of like based off the Blair Witch. Like, it's from the point of view of a camera mounted on the helmet of a soldier when Gotham gets locked down because of vampires and Batman and all this stuff happens. And I tested out this new L-Ray engine, this render engine that's John turned me on to. I didn't even know it was one of the updates.
Actually, it's iRay.
Oh, is it iRay?
Yeah, it's a capital I.
Oh, I'm sorry. I called it L-Ray because it looks the same. But yeah, oh my God. It takes forever to render, but what a difference. Holy crap. What an amazing thing. It's free, guys. If you want to download Daz Studio, go to Daz Studio. Is it DazStudio.com?
No, Daz3D.com.
Okay.
And there should be a big button on the page that says Download Studio for free.
4.9 is the latest update
Right.
Yeah. I was blown away when I tested this engine because the difference between the render I did before and after was, even though it took like 30 minutes difference, what a difference. Holy crap, I was amazed. And I'm not just saying that, it was like night and day. I mean, I had people looking at it when I was showing them the before and after, and they're like, wow. And then I used some of the shaders that they put in there. And if you learn about 3D, there's all kinds of stuff. You can learn it on videos, you can download a lot of assets, you can buy them, they're cheap. It's just, the stuff's awesome. I mean, if you guys want to make graphic novels or just learn 3D, use Daz. You go to John's website and just get started because it's an amazing hobby and you can get a lot of good work doing that. You can get into games doing that. So anyways, enough about that. So there's a lot going on this week. We've all seen Captain America Civil War. As we disclaimed in the beginning, we are going to spoil the shiz out of this one. All right, so I'm warning everybody who's listening on Subspace Radio, you might be popping in randomly. Hopefully you won't pop in the middle of us saying some spoiler, but we can't help that because we're not the video thing where we can put out like a flash warning or something like that. But the simple truth is we're doing a spoiler review, and it's been a few weeks, so I think it's fair, and it's not like we spoiled it in the first week. It was opening. So with that being said, what we're going to do is I'm going to round robin people here, and we're going to give a... Here are the rules. People are going to first just say what team they started out with. Team Cap, Team Iron Man. The reason I mentioned before and after is because Some people have started off on one team and by the end of the movie changed their minds. So I'm going to ask everybody the same question and you're going to rate it 1 to 10. 10 is like Godfather level, okay? And 1 is like the last Fantastic Four movie level. So if that should say enough right there.
Even so, that wasn't that bad.
Yeah.
And wasn't Captain America in that Fantastic Four movie?
No. I'd say a 1.
No,
would
no, you're
be...
thinking of the one with Jessica Alba. I'm talking the last one.
Oh, that one. Okay.
One would be the Doom movie they tried.
Yeah. But you know what I'm talking about.
Well, even that isn't that bad because that first-person sequence was pretty awesome.
Yeah.
Okay.
And Carl Urban and The Rock in the same movie. Awesome.
Okay, one would be the 1990s Captain America movie.
Oh, yeah, okay, yeah, that's a fair comparison, too. There you go. So one is like
I'm surprised you guys didn't say one was Star Trek V.
Okay, there's a one.
Okay, sure.
That still has a charm to it.
I'm going
to
give that one.
They did have the best one-liners in that movie, though.
That's
one at least a three.
It's a one and a half.
I would actually give 5 a 2, but that sounds weird. But anyways.
5 a 2 and a 1 and a 3.
So I'm going to say, what I'm trying to say is one is the, like, direct-to-video, like, it lasts for, like, a week in the box. Obviously, it's horrible.
Aladdin 2?
Shrek 54?
Yeah. I think
any
you get my
idea. Before time movie beyond 4.
Yeah, all right, that's fair. But basic or Police Academy after 3. All right, maybe not. Nothing, really? All right, so anyways. So,
RoboCop 3?
Yeah, all right, yeah, okay. I'll give you that one. Or, well, there's a lot of them. Anyways, the point is if you it's a 1 to 10 scale. So if you give a 10, we know that, you know, and then if you give a 1, we know. And anything in between, well, we're going to ask you to explain why you give it that rating. So we're going to go round robin, but I'm going to start with each person randomly. And then once we get past all of the reviews, I'm going to go last. If we have time, we'll talk about a couple other tidbits that came out there. Were you about to say something, John?
No, not really, but I think we should compare it to other superhero movies.
You can do that too?
I don't think you can compare it to Godfather or movies like that because they're different movies.
I'm just saying the rating system. That's all I'm saying.
Okay.
That's in terms of your opinion. Like, if you think it's a 10, it's like God. It's like classic, epic, you know, Academy Award winning kind of or Return of the King.
I'm sorry. No, we should have it within the superhero genre. I don't think any of these are, Academy winning.
Right. So, like, a 1 would be Lost in Space. Oh wait, that's not a superhero.
All right, let me put it this way: a 10 is an Academy Award winning nominated movie. A 1 is like it went right to DVD like within a couple of weeks. You know, like one of those things. You know, it doesn't have to be a specific genre. Just it either sucks.
10 is your best. 1 is your least.
There you go. There you go. So I'm actually going to start with Will because I think Will is holding back all this energy and he just wants to just kind of vomit it out. And I want to start with you today, Will.
Okay, well, thank you.
So first of all, which team are you on?
On Team Captain when I went in and I'm on Team Captain when I came out.
All right, and what would you rate the movie?
I would rate it as 11. It's 11, dude.
Really?
All the way to 11, yes.
That's
pretty
bold.
This one is my favorite superhero movie. Period of any of them, even the Christopher Nolans, even the Batmans. This one is the best because it had a compelling story. It was funny, it flowed. It had all of the superhero movies, the fighting stuff in there. It was fantastic. And you know, you obviously we're now comparing it to Batman and so forth, but comparing it to any of the other Marvel movies, comparing it to the 80s and the 90s, you know, like the Tim Burton Batmans, it's better than that. I mean, it's a different genre, if you want, Will, but I mean, it's to me, it was fantastic because of the way that they were shot, the way that the directors and the writers wrote it and pitched it, and the acting. I mean, yeah, okay, you're going to have some cheesy one-liners in there. It was funny. They had the right actors in the right positions. They left out Thor and they left out Hulk legitimately because those were two overpowered superheroes and left out Nick Fury. You really didn't want him in there because he would have had to pick one side or the other or brought them back together without fighting. That's no fun at all. And so, and again, I don't know whether are we going to discuss movie in general once everybody's because I don't want to take anybody's thunder about picking different
seasons. You can discuss whatever you want for the next... I'm going to give you 5 minutes to say whatever you want about the movie. Go ahead.
Okay, so, I mean, there's several scenes, and again, everybody can have their own scenes, but for me, it was three scenes in particular that I particularly liked, and in no particular order. Number one that really grabbed me was the one I'm particularly fantastic, thrilled about, was the airport scene, the fight scene, where all the superheroes, you've seen it on the trailers, they're running at each other, they're flying at each other. And I can't imagine how they, I mean, they I've seen things where they had to shut off a section of that airport to shoot. They had to, shoot around thunderstorms moving in and stuff like that. And it must have been a hell of a thing to try to shoot it.
They have to do like city blocks sometimes too.
Right. So, I mean, this was a big budget thrill fighting scene. I mean, there's a lot of other fighting scenes in there. But for me, that was one of the big ones because you see them all together. The other one is kind of reminded me of the Daredevil, and I think they maybe were trying to do that, where Daredevil was fighting down the stairwell, or in season one where he did that one shot take and he's going down the hallway. Captain America and Bucky, when they're trying to get out of their apartment, they did a similar thing where they're just fighting their way down this staircase, and Bucky's throwing throwing Captain America bad guys. He's almost killing people. Captain America's having to hold Bucky back from killing him. That whole fight scene was fantastic. I love the way they shot it. I love the way that they just designed it. And again, it reminded me of the Daredevil. And then the final one was the final scene at the end where Bucky and Captain America were fighting. And the reason I picked out those three is they were definitive of the overall aspect of what a superhero movie is. It's fighting. It's energetic. Also, as a side one, right after that, the stairwell fight scene, Black Panther chasing down the Bucky. That was fantastic. That whole chase scene. But anyway, that's an aside. The reason I liked this one is the airport scene. You could tell that they were holding things back. They didn't want to fight each other. They're still kind of friends. They were trying to just Iron Man's team was trying to stop Captain's team from getting to the plane to fly off, right? And that's what they were trying to do. And the other team were trying to, get some distance so they can actually get to it. And the final one, again, the big shock. I didn't realize it. I didn't see any of the spoilers. Ant-Man became small, flew on the arrow of Hawkeye, disrupted Iron Man's suit. And then when he got out of that, he said, yeah, I can become Giant Man. And he became this massive Giant Man. And it reminded me of the first Tron, right at the end where that guy becomes this big, massive, giant guy and he's blocking things. It looked exactly like that. Now,
they actually did that on Legends of Tomorrow with the Atom recently.
I know, but they had this. To me, it's like they were playing homage to a lot of these. They had references to Star Wars in there and other stuff. It was fantastic. And the reason I picked that up, this fight scene at the airport, they were holding back.
How did you feel about Spider-Man?
Well, I'll get to that. Like I said, I'm going to let other people discuss that.
Exactly. But now he's interviewing you.
Right. So again, I'm going to let other people talk about, and we can discuss Spider-Man and the Black Panther. I like it. I don't want to take anybody else's away because I want to just talk about this particular thing. The final fight scene is what defines it, because right at the end, you're thinking they're going to fight these other Winter Soldiers, and they flip it. He's killed the Winter Soldiers. He's revealed that Bucky would killed Stark's parents. And then Stark says, screw it. And Captain America, look, he was under mind meld. And Iron Man's like, I don't care. He killed my mom. And boom, it was on. And he was trying to kill Bucky. And then ultimately trying to kill Captain America. It was on. I mean, they were not holding back at that point. And that, to me, defines what happened. This is why it's a civil war. They went to war. They were trying to stop it all the way up to it. It's what wars usually happen. They're trying to hold back. Right at the end, complete split. Now you basically, theoretically, have two teams. You've got Iron Man's team, the legitimate team, the one that's sponsored by the Sokovia Accords, and then you've got the false team, the disparated team, that's ones the outlaws, if you will, of
the Secret Avengers, as they call them in the comics.
Right, and so to me, that's what this was about. It was a fantastic movie. The script flowed. Every superhero, and other ones we'll talk about, the superheroes, had their spotlight. Ant-Man was fantastic, funny. Spider-Man, fantastic, funny. But Black Panther was just phenomenal. It was great.
Yeah, he was.
He was fantastic. And it was brilliant. I mean, this to me, and I look at Captain America, the First Avenger, Winter Soldier, and then this one, it's a perfect trilogy. It is a perfect trilogy in this season. And I don't think they could even top it doing a Captain America 4. They probably need to kill Captain America and bring somebody else, Falcon or Winter Soldier, in to be Captain America now. Because really, he's done his job. Chris Evans, he can leave the series and leave this whole thing as a on top. Because he did his job. He's perfect. Really was.
All right. All right, you feel like you said enough for the moment. I don't want to interrupt.
Yeah, I'm going to let everybody else have their turn. All right.
I'm going to switch. I'm going to jump to John next, and then after that, Anthony, and then Ross. So, John, what do you think?
Okay.
Well, first of all, which team did you start with?
Me? Actually, I didn't start with either team.
Oh, which team did you end up with then?
With Team Captain.
Ah.
Yeah.
All right, and 2-0. What would you rate 2-0. It? 1 to 10.
Right. Probably a 9.
Oh, okay. Yeah. All right. And then go ahead, John. Talk to us.
So, I actually did not read the Civil War comic, so I didn't know much about it other than the very basics of how the team split apart after a big disaster. So, let's see. Yeah. I thought that it was interesting that the soldiers, like Captain America and Falcon, would be against government registration, when you would think as soldiers they would follow orders. So, but then I kind of agree with them that if they go under the orders of the United Nations, that might sound good, but then politicians might have their own agenda and send the Avengers off to somewhere that they shouldn't belong, or even not send them to a job that they should do. So I thought that was a little political commentary by Cap's team. I thought Spider-Man was very good. I thought Tom Holland did a very good job. I mean, he looks and acts like a real teenager this time, not somebody playing a teenager.
Right.
And I also like how this movie introduces him to Tony Stark, and Tony builds his outfit. So this way, in the next Spider-Man movie, you're not thinking, well, how did this teenager build himself this high-tech basketball suit armor?
And then again, he didn't build the web shooters.
Right, he did. True, yeah. But this time, oh, look, Tony Stark built it for him. So now it can be as advanced as they need it to be. I enjoyed the airport scene also. I mean, that was very good. But, yeah, you could definitely tell they were pulling their punches because they didn't want to hurt each other. Because they're all supposed to be on the same team.
Right.
So I thought that was pretty interesting, that they didn't actually try to kill each other, but it was more of a case of, let's try to work this out, stop fighting, you do what's right type of thing. So, I thought that was interesting. And again, in the battle at the end between Captain America and Bucky and Iron Man, but I just wonder why it took Iron Man so long to realize he could just blast the other guys instead of punching them.
He was trying not to hurt them, like you said. He was pulling their punches.
Right, yeah. But for a while, yeah, he was punching them, and he says, oh, find me a way to defeat Captain America, because my punching isn't working. Oh, just blast them with your lasers. Oh, there we go.
Well, he didn't want to kill them. It was a chance.
Right, yeah. Mm-hmm. So, but yeah, so overall, the movie was very good, and like he was just saying, the perfect end to the Captain America trilogy, but I bet there are going to be more. Also, the idea that all of these actors now, I think, know their character so well.
They do, yeah.
That really came out in the performances also. I mean, you have good writing and good directing, but the actors now have been in these characters, what, 4 movies?
Maybe 7 or 8 years?
You're right. Let's see. Robert Downey Jr. as Tony Stark has been in 3 Iron Man movies and 2 Avengers movies. So that's 5 movies that he's had to develop his character.
Yeah.
And again, Chris Evans, 2 Captain Americas and 2 Avengers movies.
Yep.
So going into this one, they all know their characters. They know how they would act and all that.
Even Elizabeth Olsen, even though this is only her second outing. And I agree.
Right. So, I mean, I don't mean to dump on the other big movie, Batman versus Superman.
We're talking about Civil War, so we don't even have to compare.
Okay, no comparison then. Okay. But just the point is
George, if he wants to compare, let him compare. Let the guy talk.
All right, sorry. I'm sorry.
Just the idea that with Batman and Superman, that was only Henry Cavill's second movie as Superman and Ben Affleck's first movie as Batman. So the actors didn't quite know their parts as well as all the Marvel actors
right,
and characters.
That makes sense.
I think that really helped the movie a lot. So it'll definitely be interesting to see where the characters go, especially since the new Avengers movie, or rather the next one is what, Infinity War?
Well, they just announced they're going to change the title.
Okay. Oh,
we have yet to hear what the title's going to be, but it was originally Infinity War Part 1, Part 2, but I think they're going to change it to whatever.
Ah, okay.
But it's still going to be Thanos, right?
Oh, yeah. It's just the title. I don't know if it's just that they're going to split it like Infinity War and then they're going to change the second part to a different title, but whatever. They did announce they were going to change it.
Hmm. So, yeah, it'll be interesting to see how they build it up and what kind of path do they go. Because do they make a new Hulk? Well, no, I'm sorry, Hulk wasn't in this movie, but do they make another movie in between that shows how the Avengers get back together? Or will that be the first half of the Infinity War movie?
That's the question.
So.
All right, is that...
And also that I think it was better than last year's Age of Ultron.
Oh, it spun off of it. Yeah, okay.
Right.
A lot of people agree with you, though. That it's universally being acclaimed, so...
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Okay.
Okay, so Anthony, we're going to go to you next. And first of all, I know which team you are on, Team Iron Man, right?
Do you want to just ask me what team I started
with? I'm going to ask you, what team were you on?
I thought you were going to ask me what team I started with.
Well, I'm sorry, what team did you start with?
Team Iron Man.
What team did you end with?
Team Iron Man.
All right, and what rating would you give this movie?
I would give the movie a solid 8.
Solid 8, okay. Yeah. And go ahead.
All right. So I know a lot of people are on Team Captain America. Okay. And I will say this, even though I'm Team Iron Man, now Captain America was right, but I feel he was right for the wrong reasons. Okay.
That's interesting. I'm not interrupting you. I'm just saying I think it's interesting.
Okay. Let me talk. Oh, my God. This is what's going to happen to me the entire time, right? All right, so the reason why I say he was right for the wrong reasons, his choice is based on a tendency towards a headstrong independence, and he stuck it out through that whole movie, and it was mainly pure for his personal loyalty to Bucky. The whole movie was driven for his personal loyalty to Bucky. Now, I get that. But, you know, again, ultimately, he was still right. Society cannot control superhumans. And the Sokovia Accord couldn't, you know, despite what the Sokovia Accord was, it still cannot control superhumans. If the superhuman decided they did not want to follow the Sokovia Accord, what can the humans do? Nothing. So, ultimately, Captain America was right. Okay? So... granted, I see both sides of the coin, but the reason why I am Team Iron Man is this. Okay, Iron Man and Captain America were best friends. And I know that, you know, Captain America has, you know, his relation to Bucky because Bucky is the only other person that can relate to Captain America because they both lived in the same generation during World War II.
Right.
They both survived that, right? So now to Captain America, the reason why he's so close to Bucky is Bucky understands him, and they were, you know, in that generation, when you fight together in a war, you are closer than brothers. That I get.
Yeah.
But now let's fast forward to 2016, times have changed. Bucky is a murderer, And despite the fact that he was able to be controlled, and they, you know, use these secret words to turn his brain on, and even he's like, no, don't do it, ah! Right, and now he's this murderer. He goes out and kills him. He's still murdered. Despite the fact that he was being controlled, he's still murdered. He still has to answer for those crimes. That's where Captain America was so bullheaded and independent. He did not feel that Bucky should answer for his crimes. Sort of like when the Avengers went to certain countries, fought the enemy, destroyed buildings, and killed humans. Captain America was like, well, we saved the world. He still doesn't feel that they need to answer for their crimes. On the other side of that fact, of that matter, is the reason why I like Iron Man so much, the dude is intelligent. He's extremely smart, and despite his, his ego and his love for himself, he's still smart, and he's able to rationalize and reason. He understood that the fear of the human beings, and the humans were like, we are scared because you guys could do whatever you want, and there's nothing we could do about it. We need to have a sense of control to feel a sense of security, because sometimes you guys go off. You may fight the enemy and kill and defeat them, but yet you leave a trail of blood because you got like 300 people dead. You got 3 million and 3 billion in property damage, but you're not going to answer for that. So he could see the concern of the humans. Whereas seeing Captain America is like, well, they can't control us. We're superhumans, and Captain America is 10 times the strength of a human being. So who's really going to beat him up, right? So what the deciding factor for me was in the final fight when the guy, that Russian dude, showed Iron Man that it was Bucky who killed his parents. That was raw. That was real emotion.
That was the darkest Marvel's gotten in a long time.
It was real emotion, and Iron Man was lashing out at Bucky because Bucky's the one that killed his parents. And so now Bucky's fight, is like, crap. Captain America was like, crap. He's going to try and kill Bucky. I'm going to defend Bucky against my best friend, against my friend. They're all, Captain America was friends with Bucky. Bucky's been gone for a while murdering people. And now he's friends with Iron Man. And now he's willing to take the side of the murderer against Iron Man. Because Iron Man was hurt. And crying that you're the dude that killed my parents, of course he's gonna lash out. That's raw emotion. You can't turn away from that. And then at the end, and what made me a solid Team Iron Man dude is when at the end of the fight, and Captain America disabled the Iron Man suit. He picked up Bucky. He was walking away with the shield. And then Iron Man said, you can't have that shield. That doesn't belong to you.
So you don't deserve
it. Can I talk?
Sorry.
It's my interpretation. Thank you.
Sorry.
He says to Iron Man, you can't take that shield. My dad made it. It doesn't belong to you. Iron Man threw away his identity when he dropped that shield.
You mean Captain
America? Captain America threw away his identity as a superhero. And when he walked off into the sunset with Bucky. That's why I'm a Team Iron Man, because he stuck true to his values and did not throw away his identity as a superhero and willing to work with the scared humans, because, these scared humans were like, I don't know. I mean, you could do whatever you want and there's no repercussions. Give us some assurance. The assurance was signing of the accord. That was the assurance. It made them feel better, even though technically that accord really can't control them. But Captain America was like, screw that. I'm saving Bucky. He's a murderer. He killed everybody. But I don't care. He's my friend. And he's been with me since World War II. And they're like over 100 years old and they should be dead. But, oh well, c'est la vie. So that's why I'm Team Iron Man, because Iron Man did not relinquish who he is. And he went up to Captain America and said, look, dude, I was wrong. And I'm on your side. Let's do this together.
Then he saw the video, yeah.
And then all of a sudden, still Captain America fought against his friend. I'm not cool with that at all. If my friend decided he wanted to fight me, we will never, ever be friends again. Bros before hoes. That's all I'm saying. Okay, I'm done.
Well, that was a very passionate opinion. Thank you for that. We'll go to Ross. First of all, which team did you start with? Which team did you end with?
Start and end Team Cap.
Awesome. And what was your rating?
3-1.
My rating is 9 out of 10.
All right. And carry on. Go forward with your opinion.
So I'm not going to do as much an opinion as it is a comparison. Yesterday, I read the graphic novel Civil War.
Oh, that's right.
And I'm
going to
compare the two.
Yeah, yeah. Go ahead.
Since this movie was based predominantly on that event series. Obvious differences, of course, there are no mutants, and everything involving the X-Men and Fantastic Four were completely removed from the story. This causes some differences, but the core of the story is the same.
The tone is still there, yeah.
And I'm about to say something that's probably going to get me a lot of hate. I think the movie works better than the comic event did.
I doubt it'll get you hate. The movie's universally praised.
So, and I'm going to tell you why. For the comic events, they had to manufacture a tipping point. Whereas the movie, it rose organically from the series of events that led up to that film. The entirety of the events of the Marvel Universe have built up to that point. And we see that as the Sokovia Accords are presented by now Secretary of Defense Ross. In the destruction in New York, Washington, D.C., Sokovia, and I forget the name of the African country they were in.
Wakanda. Oh, Nigeria.
Laos.
Or Laos. Yeah, it was Laos? In Nigeria, okay. I think.
Laos is in Asia.
Black Widow said, I apologize for Nigeria.
Yes.
Yeah, it was a city in Nigeria.
To King T'Challa, she said, I apologize for Nigeria.
So a lot of the things played out the same, but one of the reasons why I really think the movie works better than the comic book did, the comic events, the results were very American. The only backlash, the only changes happened in the U.S. and only the U.S. Whereas the movie, the Sokovia Accords were an international agreement ratified by the U.N. and enforced by the U.N. Whereas in the comics, yes, it was ratified by Congress, and it was only an American thing. The superhumans that didn't like it, they just left the U.S. Wolverine goes off on his own, goes back to Canada. Others, they go back to Europe or Africa or Asia or Wakanda or wherever they're from. And that was it. All of the drama happened in the United States instead of around the world. As for who picked their sides, the superheroes who stood on each side were predominantly the same. The super smart ones stuck on Team Captain America, or Team Iron Man. And the more down to earth, the more relatable guys, they stuck with Team Cap. Taking a quick breath and a drink.
I hear you.
One thing I liked about the movie that they didn't include in the movie, that is, from the comic, Tony was a lot more relatable in the movie.
Yeah, he was.
Than in the comic. In the comic events, Tony, Reed Richards, and several other of the Illuminati, the most intelligent people on the planet.
Right, which includes Charles Xavier from the X-Men.
Except him in this case.
And Doctor Strange.
They kind of went off the deep end. Except Doctor Strange. He was on team. He was on Team Cap. In that, they created a clone of Thor, because Thor was off.
Oh
dealing
yeah, the
with,
android. Yeah.
Yeah. Thor was off the planet dealing with major happenings in Asgard.
As he does.
But the hammer was still on Earth, so Richards created a clone of Thor that could wield a Mjolnir. And
was that actually Mjolnir, or was it a mimic of it?
It was a Mjolnir.
Oh, okay.
And that clone, under the control of Stark, killed Giant Man.
Yeah. Or was it Goliath?
Goliath, right.
Yeah, I forget the name. They change the names a lot.
And that's what really tipped that conflict against Cap. And in all the Marvel dark story. I mean, just it was bad. Mutant registration had been law for years, and now superhero registration was getting in. SHIELD, which is still around in the comics, was enforcing the Registration Act and actually going after and roughing up non-registered superhumans badly. Yep. You didn't see any of that in Captain America. And because of all that, because of those really dark, almost dystopian overtones, is one of the reasons why I think the movie works a lot better. Because it is a story about friends who are on opposite sides instead of two sides in a conflict, which are getting more and more extreme as the story goes on, until finally in the final battle where the two sides fighting in the middle of New York and practically leveling the city, Captain America is ready to kill Iron Man, to bring his shield down and take off his head, until he's tackled by a fireman, a police officer.
Oh,
and
yeah, I forgot about that.
I forget who else. One other person. And they tell him, stop.
Himself.
Look at what this war is doing. Look at what this battle is doing to the people around you. And he surrenders and is eventually killed in custody.
Kind of like the Supergirl moment, but a little bit different.
And now, at the end of Captain America's Civil War, yes, Cap has gone underground. He's freed everyone who fought for him, and I think they're going to be called the Secret Avengers, which I really like that.
I hope they recreate that, yes.
So you've got the Avengers, which are working with the Sokovia Accords, and then you've got the Secret Avengers, who are doing what they used to do, but more underground. You don't have any cape killers. You don't have a super oppressive mutant or super huge registration act. You don't have sentinels flying around to enforce the law. You don't have any cape killers. And you've got a good story where, yes, a lot of bad things had happened, but there's still a positive feel going forward. And in a way, Cap and Iron Man have come to terms with their disagreements and are still friends in a way.
Yeah.
And that's all I'm going to say.
That's a great comparison. I think it was interesting to sort of juxtapose the two things, the comic where it was the source material, and what the movie that the movie took from, and how the MCU took that as an inspiration, but they used their spin on it based on what they built up in their movies.
I lied. I got one more thing to say.
Okay.
I like how the other reason that the comic doesn't work was the, at least for me, was the crisis that tipped things. A superhero reality show.
Oh,
let that
yeah.
sink in for a minute. A superhero reality show with a bunch
yeah.
of teenagers called the New Warriors.
Yeah,
went up against
yeah.
a bunch of mutants who were way out of their league, and then one of the mutants had a power that he creates an explosion. He was on some
like
kind of mutant steroid that amplified his powers, and it laid waste to an entire small town, including a school.
Yeah.
And it was that conflict that tipped things instead
yeah,
of something
that
a bit
was the
more
main,
organic.
That was the main tipping point versus the things they showed in this movie.
And that's why the movie works a lot better, in my opinion.
Yeah, because they built, like you say, off of the movies. Go ahead, John.
Because they really show in the movie an entire city being destroyed and a school being destroyed. I think they made a good point in the movie saying, oh, look, New York has been destroyed. An entire country of Slovakia has been destroyed. So this movie only needed a little thing.
Well,
it didn't need an entire town to be destroyed.
Well, the only problem with the whole New York thing was it wasn't their fault at all. They
right.
were reacting to an invasion by aliens. However, Sokovia, that could have been controlled. Yeah, I mean, that's all here and there. But yeah, I know what you're saying.
And also in the Civil War comic, didn't Peter Parker reveal that he was Spider-Man?
He did. Yep. Yeah. It got erased by Lucifer, but that's a whole different
but
story.
Right. And that's one of the other things that wasn't necessary because secret identities isn't an issue.
It wasn't the issue, right.
It's not an issue in the Marvel Cinematic Universe.
As
at
long
all.
As you register, they didn't care.
No, he's saying that it's not an issue in the movies because everybody knows Tony Stark is Iron Man.
But they don't know about Spider-Man, but Tony knows who Spider-Man is. But apparently, if you watch the movie, nobody else knew. In fact, everybody was surprised. Who's this guy? And they didn't even know who Ant-Man was either. So each side had their own secret edition. You know what I'm saying?
The secret identity isn't the focus of the conflict.
Right.
Accountability was.
Accountability.
And that's a much better story. That's a lot more effective, I think.
Okay, George, why don't you give us your opinion?
Right. All right.
So which side did you choose before you went?
All right. I started with Team Cap, and I ended with Team Cap. I give the movie higher than all of you guys. I give it a 10 out of 10. And I'm not just saying that to be a fanboy. I'm actually not a Marvel fanboy.
Will gave it an 11.
Oh, yeah, he did. That's right. But I'm going with 10. I'm going to say 10 out of 10 because it was just that there's just no faults. It was just that the Russo brothers are amazing. I'm going to start with Hot Aunt May, Marisa Tomei. Okay. That was awesome. A little known trivia, Robert Downey Jr. and Marisa Tomei did a romance movie together where they did a couch scene that was actually what they were trying to call back to when the Russo brothers filmed that scene. Everybody was like, there's like a lot of controversy about, is it okay to have a hot Aunt May because of all the history about the old Aunt May? My opinion, not only am I okay with it, that's one of those liberties you can take without being like, I want to see where they go with this when the next movie comes out, Homecoming. I'm very curious. So that means Uncle Ben was probably younger too when he died. So hot Aunt May, I have no problem with it, whereas all the fanboys are going, I'm not sure how I feel about that. You know, I think it was great. And I think the way that Tony Stark played off of that whole flirtation was great. Ant-Man was, I just had seen Ant-Man a couple of weeks ago for the first time, and he was funny, he was perfect, his giant man moment was awesome, the moment where, my favorite line in the entire movie was in, he grows for the first time, and Spider-Man goes, holy shit, I mean, that was awesome, I mean, the two of them played off each other, like the two bugs swatting each other, it was awesome, I love the part where Spider-Man's crawling over his helmet, like a bug, it was so cute. It just worked. They did such little things, and then of course, there's a lot of people are not talking about Vision and Scarlet Witch when they were flirting with each other in the kitchen. In the comics, they get married, and I'm really curious as to how far they're going to go with that that storyline in this version because they are meant to be in the comics. They fall in love and they get married, and they really sort of tease that when they're flirting with each other, when he's trying to like make her happy and he's trying to make a dish he's never eaten food before. I love that little moment. I thought it was so cute, and she's kind of liking how he's flirting with her and paying attention to her because Iron Man locks her up in the apartment, you know what I mean? And it's like, that is something a lot of people don't talk about, but I think it was really interesting. And then the other thing is, nobody talks about this, Black Widow went to that funeral for Peggy Carter. She died in this movie. That's a big thing. They threw it in there, but Cap goes to her funeral, and Black Widow goes there to be there for him as a friend. And I think this is important because it's important to lead into that before they get fighting, because especially when she turns sides and switches to Team Cap, sort of, when she stops Black Panther, because she and Cap have had in Winter Soldier, have built up a friendship, and she only went to that funeral in Britain because she didn't want him to be alone. And I thought that was a very emotional moment, and he, you know, she of course reported to him who signed what, but he asked, so why are you here? I didn't want you to be alone. Quiet moment, not a very exciting moment as far as action goes, but I thought it was a big character development thing for the two characters. It kind of spins off of what happened in Winter Soldier, where they'd gotten close as friends, not in a romantic area, but you know, they're just good friends, they're colleagues, and this, to me, that was a big moment. She knew how much Peggy meant. The other thing I'm going to mention is Sharon Carter. Nobody's talking about her either. In the comics, she's the love of Captain America's life, and him, even though it was kind of forced,
she kills him.
she, well, under the control of what's his face. But in the this, the way that they built up to her getting the actress, when she had that look in her face, and he knew, I should move in for the kiss. And then that funny moment when Falcon and Bucky kind of giving him the whole bro thing in the car, that was awesome. That was like one of those moments where it was like, and he's giving them look like, what? You know, that was awesome. Because in the comics, there's two, Sharon and Captain America are Lois Lane and Clark Kent. They're like, you know, Diana Prince and Steve Trevor. They are the loves of each other's lives. And, you know, I thought that was awesome. I would have preferred it if they had picked the actress who played Peggy Carter to also play Sharon Carter. Because in the comics, she's supposed to look almost identical. And Cap's supposed to be taken aback by that. But that's fine. I mean, I didn't think she was awesome in Winter Soldier, but in this movie, at the point where they kissed, I was fine with it. I thought that they're building up to something very interesting. It feels right. That's just my opinion. And I just think that, you know, they just hit all the right beats in this movie. And you walk away from this movie going, Jesus, you know, can Russo's brothers do any wrong? Did they leave anything on the cutting room floor? Because this is amazing. And
no,
I can't
apparently.
Wait. Yeah, I can't wait to see what they do next. They just go for it. They kind of do what the Flash TV show does. They just take the material and they go, let's just do it. Let's just do it. And they did. They just hit all the right beats. The Vision was amazing. Even though he was very, like, he's probably the most powerful member of the whole, you know, he could have screwed them all over if he really wanted to. He could have gone inside Ant-Man's chest and killed him. Like Zoom does on Flash, you know what I mean? But he didn't, because he's holding back. He's got that gem. He even talks about it to Scarlet Witch. He's like, I don't know what it does, but I know it's powerful, and I know I have to study it more, and I don't know. I want to be careful, and he's kind of implying he wants to be responsible, because he doesn't know what it can really do. And if you notice in some parts of the movie, he's not wearing it on his head. And that says a lot, because he knows he needs to be careful about how often he has it on his head. So when he's wearing the vest, he doesn't wear it on his head at all. But when he's in his regular costume, he does. A lot of people miss that, but it's something that is true in the movie. I think he does it because he knows that it's like too much power. I don't want to get, I just got born yesterday, like he said to Ultron, you know, and he wants to take it easy. He wants to transition into being a responsible living being now. And I just think this movie has so many things that are worth revisiting if you watch the movie more than once. So, obviously, I'm loving the movie, and that's my opinion.
Well, I want to get to something that Anthony touched on.
Sure.
He mentioned something about Winter Soldier needing to be held accountable for his crimes, and I agree. Right. Right? I don't know whether you're still there, Anthony, or not.
Yeah, I'm here.
But in that regards, who built, or who designed, who created Ultron? It was Iron Man, right?
Yeah.
Everybody else told him not to do it. He even had an argument. I think it was Captain.
He only told Banner. And Banner
right, but they had an argument. Don't do it. But he did it anyway. Should Iron Man be held accountable for? He's the one that created Ultron. That's lifted that piece of rock.
Well, that's the whole reason he signed the Accords. He felt guilty.
Right. But in that regards, he's trying to bring Bucky to justice, and then ultimately.
Yeah, but
kill
you
got to
understand that Iron Man signed the Accord, which makes him. You know, he bound himself for his actions. He had guilt.
No greater zealot than a convert.
So all of a sudden, he signs a piece of paper and he gets absconded, or he gets sins washed away?
Well, he acknowledged his mistake.
That's not right.
The whole speech he gave to Captain America as to why we should do it.
It's not right for whom? Because the 110 nations said, if you sign this, we'll be happy and you'll be exonerated.
But Zemo didn't like it, or Zemo.
Well, the one whose son got killed,
yeah,
was played by Alfred.
He would not have accepted it. He didn't accept it.
That's fine, but that's him. He was not part of the original Avengers.
Who?
Are you talking about Black Panther?
No, Zemo.
Oh, we're talking about
the man.
Oh, Zemo. Oh.
The man was actually driving this rift between the Avengers. He had his family killed in Sokovia. He didn't give a damn about that accord.
He's saying Iron Man built Ultron.
There's probably thousands of more people in that city or that country that didn't give a damn about what the UN wants. They wanted reparations. They wanted these people to be brought to justice.
See, this actually...
But how does that make Captain America right?
Oh, it doesn't. I'm not saying he is right. They are both wrong, and they are both... I mean, that's the unique thing about this movie.
Yeah.
They have they both have their viewpoints, and they express them very well. And in this case, Iron Man defending Captain, you know, Bucky, just because he's his friend, is wrong.
But the thing
I think is, he wasn't doing it just for that. He wanted to actually find out he trusted his friend, right? And then when he investigated more, he found out his friend was being set up. So his trust, and this is the thing with Captain America. And this goes back to the first one. And this is the theme that has been running through these trilogy. Is in the first one, he was a government man. He served his country. He joined the Earth. He let them test serum on his body just to serve, right? So he did all that. He went to war. And then in the Winter Soldier, he was a government man. He was working with S.H.I.E.L.D. Then S.H.I.E.L.D. turned out to be infiltrated by Hydra. And he became completely disillusioned with government.
Like you said, the agendas change.
Right, but in this one, okay, so he's like, I can't trust government anymore. So he's complete flip, whereas in Iron Man, Tony was like, screw that, I don't give a crap about, right at the end of Iron Man, or beginning of Iron Man 2, he's on Capitol Hill. You can't take my suits. You know, I have, what did he say? He was like, he has successfully privatized.
They were going to use his suits for military use.
Right, but he's like, I'm not giving them to you. Wouldn't, if he was a military, if he was a government man, he would have given them to the government to control. He was not like way in Iron Man 2. You've seen a complete flip with these two characters. It's a juxtaposition between where they started and where they're ending.
That's fine, Will, but I don't see it as a flip.
It's not a flip.
What it was is that Iron Man realized, you know, when it was brought to their attention that, hey, you guys could do whatever you want. You go around, you do fight the bad guys, and you do defeat them. However, what about the damages that you have caused? Damage to buildings, damage to lives, and there's no repercussions from that.
Yep,
that was the point.
The difference between the beginning of these characters and where they are now, it's not so much a flip in their ideals, just a change in perspective.
Yes.
Cap has always been an embodiment of the ideal of the American dream. He crusades for freedom and justice for the individual within the American system. While Tony, he disproved of having his suits taken away from him. But now he is choosing to contribute towards the greater good within the system.
It's how
instead of having that choice taken away from him.
Yeah, it's how the weapons were used. Like he said, it was when I saw how my weapons were used is when I changed. That's what he actually said to Captain America. He said, until my weapons were used for this reason. Like, Ultron used his Iron Legion to do all that damage to Sokovia. That was the whole point. He created the Iron Legion to help people, but when Ultron took control of them, it flipped it to where his own weapons were used as the weapon.
Okay, let's take that. Let's take it from that premise. It's these superheroes are out of control or not being controlled. Has Captain America done anything within these three, just his three movies, that has been detrimental to the world order? I mean, in the
answer is no.
No,
but what he has done.
Let me finish, please. All
right,
let me finish. In the first one, when he was getting that serum, and he says, "Look, the serum amplifies everything in you, including any kind of spirituality, any kind of thought, any kind of second." You know, he's basically saying that he's always trusted his gut. Right, and so this serum is probably an enhances ability to trust his gut, if you will, or that sixth sense. Right, whereas so the Captain America seems to me in just these three movies makes the right choice, the moral, you know, trying to save people. Maybe he gets, you know, being brought into the Avengers. I mean, the Battle for New York and Sokovia gets out of control. Whereas Iron Man, his choices are ultimately always detrimental. I mean, he created the guy in the third movie, right? Because he basically told him to meet him on the roof and blew him off, you know, told him to screw away. He created the you know, when we're talking about the Ultron, right? He created that. He's basically screwed himself repeatedly throughout these history movies.
Which is why he signed the Accord,
because he knew of his actions. You can't blame Tony for the guy from 3. He made his own choices. Yes, he was inspired by the mistreatment he received under Stark, but you can't blame Stark for the creation of the Mandarin.
He says, you make enemies. That's what he said at the beginning of that movie.
Yes, you make enemies. But you can't blame Stark for the decisions of someone else.
John, you were about to say something. What was it?
Nope, I agree. Yeah.
Oh, I was going
to say,
Tony...
was up to that guy, the Mandarin guy in Iron Man 3, to decide to be angry instead of just saying, oh, well, Tony didn't show up, whatever.
Yeah, and Tony has always been selfish, but he's regretting the results of his selfishness.
Right.
Whereas Cap has always been the opposite. He's been selfless. He's been selfless, and he stayed consistent.
He was selfless until he decided that he wanted to protect Bucky.
But he knows that
who's
Bucky's
a murderer.
Over.
But no,
he doesn't see it like he's a murderer.
No, exactly.
Bucky is a murderer.
Not by choice.
He was controlled or not, he still committed the crime. Even Bucky himself said, "I still committed the crime."
All right, well, you know, this is where there's a moral argument.
Iron Man has to be held accountable for Sokovia. Just because he signed the Accords is irrelevant.
Iron Man knew he had to do that.
But see, someone's brainwashed, that's the whole argument. Are they really, even if they are going to have that whole guilt and they say they're responsible, are they really? If somebody's been literally brainwashed to turn into a machine of war... Are they really responsible for what they did? Because I don't think they are.
It probably should be.
I do believe that all superhumans are responsible for their actions.
Anybody in real life, they've had people brainwashed.
But if you're controlled, what kind of ability do you have to say no? You don't.
You don't.
And tell me how that stands up in court, especially people who said they were sleepwalking
and
killed their spouse and still went to prison.
That's why this is scientifically proven. They have the formula. They have the suit.
I get that, Will, but still the person committed the act, whether he was in control or not.
I agree with you, Anthony. I actually think that what you bring up is a great argument. That is a legitimate argument. I'm not arguing that there is room to debate about that, but there is a debate. That's all I'm saying.
Oh, I think it should be brought into a court of law, definitely. And I said that Captain America's defending him is wrong. But the thing with Captain America is he's always relied on his sense of perspective, where he's going, and he's always been true to himself. He's always trusted his friends, and he's trusted this is what he wants, and his trust in Bucky and this kind of proven true because he didn't commit the crime, of killing, setting that bomb outside where they were signing it. Listen, so when we get to this point, you know, Iron Man and all of the other people who signed it want to be controlled. Great. And
They did not want to be controlled. They signed it to alleviate the fears of the humans.
They want to give accountability. They want to give a sense of like everybody calms down because they're under a official kind of police like license to do what.
Right. What did Black Widow say in the movie?
I forget.
It's not about control. It's about accountability.
Yeah.
Oversight. That there is supervision. That these superpowered beings have
they need to win back the trust of the people.
An organizational structure. They answer to someone.
But then Cap was like, okay, you have this political agenda or this political arm, and we've all seen it in our own society. When they try to act, they're always too slow. They never act quickly.
Like the council in Star Wars.
And so the captain's like, look, if I need to act, and this is exactly when Stark and Spider-Man were in the same room together. Spider-Man's like, look, if I have this power and I don't do something, I see somebody get hurt, that's on me. And that's, I think, when Stark was first realizing this is exactly what Cap was saying.
Right, so that goes back to the government, even the UN, will they have to take a vote before sending out the Avengers?
Will they have to council
and debate it? And
No. The fact of the matter is this. Some countries don't want the Avengers resolving their issues. That was the whole point right there. Whereas the Avengers before are like, oh, some aliens have come to Earth. Let's go destroy them. And then they go to this country, unasked, and then dispatch the aliens, also creating $3 billion worth of property damage and countless lives. But so Captain that was America, the issue.
Here's the issue that I predict is what Cap was trying to imply. They don't know whether there's still any elements of Hydra that are still controlling certain elements of the entire world as far as the political agenda. That's what I gathered from it. Somebody from Hydra or former Hydra could be giving a vote or making them say, send the Avengers here, like kind of implying you need to go to this country. Or no, don't let them go to this country because we got some kind of operation going on and there's corruption behind the scenes.
Yeah, that's getting a little too deep.
But that's now balanced out.
I really think that's what he was implying.
But no, the thing is, when Earth was attacked from space, it was New York. They couldn't do anything about that. They just had to come in and fight off the bad guys as much. Sokovia and everything else from that point has because of what the Avengers did.
Yeah,
it's Iron Man who did it.
Well, he was trying to help.
For the death, which is perfectly legitimate, you can, then Iron Man has to be held accountable too, because he's the one responsible for that. Banner said, look, don't do this. This is too dangerous. But he did it anyway because he thought this is what we need. And his thing is, his instincts have always been wrong, whereas Cap's instincts have always been right. That's why I'm a Cap guy.
Yeah,
because his instincts have always been right.
Old school apple pie is the way to go. It's just then.
But Tony isn't the one making the decisions now. He's running the Avengers, but he's got Ross's oversight.
Yeah.
Well, okay. Let's take a step back. What did he say at the end of the movie? Oh yeah, just call me. I want to push that little button. We'll see a little blinking.
He's Tony Stank.
And the thing is, okay, what kind of team does he have now? He's got a busted up war machine that can't walk. He's got Vision, and then he's got himself. Maybe Spider-Man.
Vision, yeah.
So, I mean, the thing is, okay, so then he's gonna have to wait for UN to say, yeah, go with this, go there, go that. If that's what he wants to do. You think Iron Man, you think Tony would ever let anybody tell him what to do?
Yeah, and they got now, Captain Marvel
after
coming
everything
in the next
that's happened, yeah.
I mean, should he be held accountable for going after Bucky without telling the UN? I mean, he broke the Sokovia Accords at that point.
Well, he's a criminal now. He's a fugitive.
Well, no, Captain is, but it's Iron Man. He went after Bucky, followed them to Russia.
No, because Captain America and Bucky were fugitives at that point, so he was actually doing something they probably had a warrant out for.
So he followed them to Russia to capture them, but instead he hooked up with them to fight off the Winter Soldier.
It wasn't Russia, it was in international waters at a prison.
When they were into Russia on the ice cap, when they found the Winter Soldiers, that was Russia.
Okay.
Was the prison where they put the rest of
the raft.
John, you got to keep talking if you want to get your point across.
I know, yeah. So do you think Russia would vote to allow Iron Man to fly into their airspace?
Ah, good point.
Even to go after
depends
Captain
on the
America.
Threat.
No, yeah. They wouldn't. Because they would want their own superheroes.
Right.
I never thought about that.
Then why did they let Captain America go in there?
They didn't.
They probably didn't.
The same reason why Iron Man was in there. They didn't know.
Right. I agree.
So then
now the Avengers is a UN organization instead of an American one.
Well, that's the way it was in the comics, too.
Well, that's what the Sokovia Accord was. It was 110 nations.
They called it the Superhero Registration Act, as Ross will attest in the comics, but in this Sokovia Accords. But either way, yeah, it made it like a legitimate organization. It wasn't worldwide in the comics. It was a USA thing. But yeah, in this universal context of this cinematic story arc that's been going on since Iron Man started, it made sense.
Sokovia Accord was based out of fear. That was the entirety of the Sokovia Accord.
Go ahead, Russ.
The Sokovia Accords isn't like the Superhuman Registration Act. That was a very sweeping, very oppressive
legislation. That was just identifying control.
Just like the Mutant Registration Act. They limited what they could do and who they had to report to in a very in a very harsh way. The Sokovia Accords, like Ross said, was a very middle ground document that is international instead of just American.
Yeah, you are Ross. You said, like Ross said, that was a weird first person.
Ross, as in the Secretary of State General.
Oh!
Ross.
You want to control me? I'm going to Canada.
Just so you guys know, this is just a little trivia I'm going to throw out there on the side. This storyline for Civil War, both in the comics and the movie, it's not Marvel's original thing. They copied DC's Kingdom Come. Ross, you probably know what I'm talking about. John, maybe you too.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Kingdom
really?
Comes okay. a very different kind of
But
story.
No, but they had a whole thing where they made a sort of a registration act, and Superman was like Tony Stark, and Batman was like Captain America, where as far as who believed in what.
And then there was a big disaster.
And there was a big disaster. And by the end, everybody made nice. But Superman was, because Lois died, and so did Kingdom Come took place like way ahead in the DC. It was written by the guy who did Watchmen.
Yeah, and it ended with Superman ready to nuke all of existence.
Yeah, Superman, it was one of the most popular graphic novels ever
done.
Let's
save that for a different discussion.
Yeah,
we can talk about that for hours.
It was very similar to, and it came first, to Civil War.
Yeah,
and
with this movie, I mean, they brought up some very prevalent and timely things that we're having in discussion with our own societies. I mean,
that's true.
About government control. I mean, this is what the debate that we're having today within our own societies, which I find fascinating, because we're having this debate, and in this movie, they're having this split between these people. But what did you think of the split of who went where? I mean, to me, I pretty much called that Black Widow would change sides, basically. Would she be one side and then she'd be on the other?
I think.
I'm going to say that she didn't change sides. She held true to what she said.
But if she was on Captain Iron Man, she would have caught, she would have arrested them there. She wouldn't let him get on the
plane. No, she didn't switch
no,
sides.
No, I disagree.
She says she had some sympathy at one point.
Well, yeah, so she was playing both sides like a spy. She
I really
sides.
Don't think she did that. I think she just had a moment where she said, I don't want to arrest
this
guy.
She was conflicted. She didn't know who she wanted both
sides. No, she knew that the Black Panther wanted to kill Bucky.
Yeah.
And that was not the whole point of the fight.
Yeah.
She trusted Steve's motivations more than she did Black Panther's. Although at the same time, she understood the necessity of the Sokovia Accords.
She didn't change sides. She was like a cop who you might like has a fellow cop that goes rogue, but she was the partner of that cop.
You're parsing. I think she flipped sides. She changed sides.
I don't think she did.
Changed sides.
Changing sides is when you completely go over. I don't think she did that.
Well, she let him go.
Yeah,
the whole purpose of them being at the airport.
She wasn't in the prison at the
end.
She wasn't in the prison at the end, unlike Falcon and Hawkeye and everybody else. So that tells me they didn't recognize her as a traitor.
Well, yeah, because
she also stopped. The only person she stopped was Black Panther.
And he technically wasn't on anybody's side.
Yeah, instead of being in prison, she assaulted a... A head of state,
king of a country.
He wasn't on a registered side, so she didn't technically turn against Cap. I mean, Iron Man and all them.
This is the thing, though: is Black Widow a superhero? She doesn't have any superpowers. Why
you don't
have
to have superpowers. Hawkeye's a hero,
but no superhero.
About Hawkeye?
Well, yeah, they're not superheroes. They are heroes.
No, they're superheroes. They have enhanced abilities, whether it's technology.
What is her enhanced? She is exceptionally fast and quick, but is it superhuman like Steve Rogers?
She is the epitome. She is the pinnacle of a spy.
She also has
she's
gear.
Been trained
so she's
to,
human. She's still human.
That
she's
doesn't
human.
Make her not a superhero.
She's Batman.
Yes.
Right. She, I mean, so
except
over
she's
her...
had her ovaries cut out.
Yeah, that's
the Hulk. Oh, dang. And she's banging the Hulk.
Right.
Well, we haven't seen
she
actually banged him. We saw that she wanted
to. But that's the thing.
Yeah, Hulk smashed her.
Why would you have human beings who are just normal human beings, exceptional human beings, have to sign the Accords? That would be people that are exceptionally
gifted. They wanted all the Avengers to sign it, whether you're a superhuman or not.
So they were targeting just the Avengers?
They were targeting anybody who's considered a member of these teams that go off and do what they do.
But this is something that you alluded to in the movie, that and again with the Avengers, the world is filling up with people that are overmatched.
They said that, but if you're a member of this team, whether you're a metahuman or whether you're a normal human
right.
with a
but
special gear, you're still part of that group.
The only real team that we know about right now is the Avengers. What other teams right. are out there?
The thing with the Avengers is that they are a very public face
yeah.
of a global issue. The Avengers are out there. They're visible. They're public. So they are in the public eye. When people need to focus on something, they're not going to look at some shady organization that may or may not be out there. They might cast an eye towards the costume vigilante that's running around some obscure
Hell's
neighborhood
kitchen.
In New York. Uh-huh. But they are going to focus on the very public group that are conducting operations internationally with no oversight and no supervision.
And
okay,
like
here's
the
a question.
Like
here's
the question. Vision said, well, like the Vision said, our existence invites competition, which invites chaos.
Here's a question. If Spider-Man was on Team Captain, and did he have to sign the Scovia Accords, and now he's not able to operate in New York?
We never got an answer about that.
No, I thought he was on Iron Man's team.
He was.
He's on Iron Man's team.
We never actually heard them say
he signed
it.
Accords, and if
well,
he did,
I guess we're
going to
find
able
out.
To operate in New York anymore.
I think
we do not
out.
Know if he signed the Accord or not.
Not
Iron
yet,
Man is
think...
supposed to show up in the
he
Spider-Man
in
movie,
Homecoming.
So maybe
he was the trump card. For
yep.
Team Iron Man.
I think in Spider-Man Homecoming, we're going to get some of those answers.
Sort of like Ant-Man was for Team Captain.
Well, Spider-Man's movie is what's coming up next in the whole lineup.
Well, no, it's Doctor Strange.
Reading into it.
No, Spider-Man comes out before Doctor Strange.
No, Doctor Strange is this
oh,
this
no,
fall.
You're right. It comes out in the next
Thank
one.
You.
It takes place after Civil War, though.
Spider-Man's next year, this time next year.
Yeah.
So Doctor Strange is in the fall. The thing that I'm getting at is, Iron Man's going around recruiting these superheroes, but he's not getting them to sign the Scovia Accords.
We don't
that's,
know.
That's right, yeah.
He's basically...
Yeah, but what about Ant-Man? He didn't, you know...
Ant-Man,
they pulled him out of the woodwork.
Right,
what are you talking about?
He's on the
about?
Bad guy team.
He's
on Team Cap. He
Captain
doesn't have
America.
To sign it.
You just said he was on that bad guy team.
Yes.
Oh.
And you're supposed to be Team Cap.
Well,
they're not the
I'm
bad
talking
guys.
About from your perspective. From your perspective, he's the
No, you
captain.
Didn't. Well, knock it off.
Ant-Man, right? both this
right?
guy
he's
and
he's the bad
him.
Guy team. For me, he's the good guy team.
Mm-hmm. Ant-Man's kind of always been on the down low. I mean,
he's a criminal.
He's an ex-con.
Yeah.
He is literally an ex-con.
Right, he's
yeah.
not going to sign it.
Not only that, but Pym's a rival of Stark, so. However,
yeah,
he did
they
work
don't
with
like
Peggy,
each other.
So maybe he get along with Captain America. Oh, then he already does. Anyways, there's so much we could talk about with
changing
Civil War.
The subject.
Am I the only one that they took advantage of the Scarlet Witch because she was young and didn't know better?
What do you mean?
No.
Well, think about it. You know, Captain America wanted the Scarlet Witch on her side.
She was locked in a room, like she said to
I mean, on
Iron
side.
Man. She's like, oh.
Yeah, okay. Iron Man put her in the room to protect her from
yeah,
the people.
But she
no,
said,
put
baby
no,
in the corner.
He put her in there to protect.
He put baby in the corner.
He put her in the room to protect the people from her.
Because she accidentally killed a couple of people because she was trying to save Cap.
He locked
I mean,
her away. He imprisoned her. And then she figured
yeah.
that out.
I will let you believe that.
I believe that. I'll let you believe whatever
well,
you like.
Well, let me put it to you this way.
Crap.
We can go on and on about Civil
wow,
War.
Wow, Will. I never passed judgment on your perspective.
You should,
but if you're going to do that, wow.
Okay.
What does that say?
The
well,
thing
you,
that, this
I mean,
is why
losing,
the movie was
you're
so
losing
good.
Because we're 3-1, so it's Captain.
But
no, it's fine. Here. Everybody's against me. That's fine. But the fact of the matter is this. Is that she was in her room to protect her from the masses who were
no.
scared of her.
No,
they,
I think
protecting
she was
the
in
masses
they,
from
the
her.
Humans were scared
Keep talking
of her.
To her. If you start
no,
talking, just
right,
don't stop.
Yeah, okay. No, I think she was in her room to prevent her from accidentally doing something. She goes into town, somebody gets upset with her. Oh, look, there's that crazy Avenger
Based
lady.
Based on fear.
Right, on fear, but then she gets upset, uses her powers, destroys a car or hurts somebody and
like
it makes things worse.
Penis off,
so where
yeah.
so why is that so why is the decision to keep her in the house not based on wisdom?
It's kind of
because
a parallel with the graphic novel series where Johnny Storm goes out one day after the key events and gets assaulted and is put into a coma for the entire
Oh yeah
events.
From Civil War yeah, yeah.
But would you want to be locked up in your room?
No.
Well, of course not.
She made
no, nobody crazy. Wants to be locked up
well,
in their room, Will.
Made,
come on.
But then,
where are you coming up with that question?
But then, she made a mistake by trying to save Cap.
He was doing that to protect her and the populace.
No.
There is a reason for that, Will.
No.
Why would she like it? Why would she accept it?
Nobody would like it. Trust
she
me. But there's reason and knowledge for that.
She made a mistake.
There's a reason for it.
Fine, no, I disagree with you.
It's for protection of her.
Everybody makes mistakes in the middle of a battle. Okay, she made a mistake by trying to save Cap.
I don't know what I'm talking about.
She was trying to save Cap, and she quickly tossed the bomb. It just happened to go in the direction of where there was people. Now there was people everywhere. It was an easy mistake. She's a noob, and so for him to lock her.
Every teenager is going to rebel.
That happened, okay? What we're talking about now is the repercussions from it. She would not want to say...
Megan's
perfectly acceptable. They want to protect the people from her or her from the people. They don't want to get them mixed. Well, she doesn't have to accept it, and she's not...
But when do you say, okay...
She also wasn't an American citizen, and that was an issue.
That's true, yeah. But when do you say, okay, so, now you can come out of your room? When you've had, like, another 5 years of training? I mean, that's where it was getting, like...
That's a what-if, and I don't deal with what-ifs.
Yeah, well, she's a girl.
And it's not just her room. It's what, the 180-acre compound? And
she was like,
she had plenty of room to run around in.
I'm sorry. That's
no,
a cage.
I'm just saying. Don't hate.
Right, yeah.
Her mistake was something any of the Avengers could have made. So for him to judge her and say, just because you happen to.
There was no judgment involved.
Yes, it was. She was trying to save Captain America. She made. She quickly tossed the bomb. She didn't think about where she was tossing it, and it happened to be into
a
building.
She was being in a teenager.
George, you're focusing on the wrong thing.
All right.
The thing we're arguing about here is her choice to leave the compound.
Well, yeah, she had every right to.
Did she?
Yeah. In her mind.
She had not signed the Sokovia Accords. She's not an American. She's a illegal immigrant residing in the United States.
Not
why
by
was
choice.
She just extradited?
Not by
to
choice.
Where?
Captain America
Sokovia
and the Avengers brought her over.
Anymore?
They recruited her. She was brought over.
You can send her anywhere.
You're just making excuses.
The thing is, Gilded Cage is still a Gilded Cage.
Yeah.
People are not going to want to sit in it.
Any argument we were on the side of Scarlet Witch, I'm going to go with.
She escaped with the help of Hawkeye, and they joined King Captain. So.
I feel ganged up upon.
Yes, well, you should. You're on the wrong side.
You are.
I'm not on the wrong side. Everyone is welcome to their own side and decision. You should respect mine like I respect yours.
We do respect yours.
I even said that Captain was right, but there's a reason why I chose Iron Man.
Allow me to
placate you a little bit. I got to say that Tony in this movie was definitely a lot more relatable and a lot more sympathetic.
I agree with you there.
He didn't feel like he went off the deep end or off to an extreme.
Tony himself almost changed sides at the end until he saw the footage.
You look at Iron Man, you look at Avengers Ultron, where he created Ultron. And I'm like, why are you doing that? It's like me in The Flash. Why is this person doing this when everybody's telling them don't do it? He did it anyway. In this movie, he's actually thinking about things. I agree with Anthony. He signed him because of his guilt. That's perfectly acceptable.
And he almost changed sides. He came very close. He almost thought he did the wrong thing until he saw the footage. Then it became personal.
I don't think he would have. He was still figuring.
He was on the fence.
Know that Bucky did not set the bomb off outside the
right,
UN.
Right, but he was starting.
But he
to
wanted
feel
to kill
like
Bucky because he killed his parents. Anthony's right about that one. It was all emotion at that point. He didn't care about the Scovia Accords. He didn't care about anything else. He just wanted to kill Bucky because he killed his mom. Oh,
but he didn't find that out till the end.
But that's the point of the
It doesn't matter when he found it
What's
out.
Was her name Wanda? Sorry, Martha.
Damn it. Right. Was her name Martha?
No, Martha. But Anthony was right. At the end, it was all emotion. That's what was driving him towards that. Scovia Accords were out of the question. He wasn't even thinking about the Scovia Accords. He didn't give a crap.
And I loved how
he
Black
wanted
Panther
to kill,
stopped.
He
the,
wanted to kill Bucky.
I wasn't a big fan of the bad guy at first. I thought he was just thrown in there because Marvel doesn't really do bad guys very well. But I will admit this. When I thought about it later, the way Black Panther stopped him from when he realized when the guy admitted his what he did, how he had broken up the Avengers, basically, as revenge for what happened in Sokovia. The fact that how many people in real life that are bad guys do the whole murder-suicide thing, and it's you don't get any justice because they kill them.
That's right, yeah.
You know what I mean? They killed a woman, and then they kill themselves. So there's no real justice because they don't get to be held accountable because they took themselves out. He stopped him from doing that. And I thought that was very brave of Marvel to throw that part in there. because I don't think a lot of people thought about that, how powerful that moment was, because he was about to say, screw it, I did my thing, I got what I wanted, now I'm out of here. And he was getting ready to take himself out, and Black Panther stops him and said, we're not done with you.
That follows Black Panther's MO. I mean, that's what he is.
And that was why he was awesome.
I want to do a comparison between the bad guy in Batman Superman, who set up the Batman Superman villains and didn't really work that kind of...
Oh, you mean Luthor?
Luthor. Whereas this guy, even though he was a small role, even though he may be bigger, Zemo is actually a bigger character
Big character in the comics, yeah.
And I'm sure he's going to escape from that prison and do something else and later on. But the thing is, his actually made sense. It actually made sense why and how he got them to fight. It made a lot of sense.
Yeah. What were you going to say, Ross?
Did you guys notice Black Panther's sister?
The bald girl?
Yes. Move, or I'll make you move.
Yeah. I wish they had thrown down.
Well, apparently in the comics, she eventually becomes Black Panther as well.
Oh, really? That's cool.
Where T'Challa becomes King of the Dead.
It would be cool if Black Panther eventually marries Storm
We might actually see that in the Black Panther movie.
Well, they'd have to get the rights from Fox to do the thing like this.
Why do I always think of the bounty hunter from Firefly?
And I also got to say that, good reference there. I loved Falcon and Bucky in this movie. Their charisma together.
Yes, especially when they're fighting Spider-Man. That was awesome.
The moment where they're in the car. Can you move your seat up?
The whole...
Right.
And when he's watching Cap and Sharon. That was awesome.
It was a nice bromance rivalry. The new friend and the old friend.
You see the motif that was running through it where they're in the car with Black Panther and he says, oh, you like cats, do you? And then when he's turning in his gear at the raft or the UN and they return the receipt and he says bird suit or bird costume. Bird costume. He's like, come on.
That was funny as heck.
There's a whole animal motif running through it. And Spider-Man's running along the side of the wall.
I can't believe how little we've in this whole... hour and 22 minutes. I can't believe how little we've talked about Tom Holland as Spider-Man. Let's just talk about him for at least 5 minutes. I mean,
he was perfect.
And I like how the characters are commenting. You know, we usually don't talk this much when we fight.
I know.
It's right at the end when him and Falcon.
That dude was talking more than a woman, right?
He would be like me if I was a superhero.
He's like, yo, dude, he's like. It was funny.
Mr. Stark said you would say that, and he also said you would think you're right, but you're wrong, and blah, blah, blah.
When he flipped in and he's got the cap shield and he starts talking, and Iron Man looks over and he says, look, I mean, I forget what he says, but he says, shut up, basically. Don't talk as much.
He was trying to tell him, like, the costume's good, it works, don't worry, I'm not complaining, Mr. Stark. And he's like, okay, we don't need to have a conversation.
right. I mean, he's just talking and talking away.
I don't know if you guys saw the end credit scenes, but one of the scenes was Spider-Man experimenting with his new web shooters that Tony gave him, and he does this spotlight that's only been in the animated series, not even in the comics.
It was in the comics.
Oh, was it in the comics?
Yeah.
Oh, all right.
He uses a flashlight and as kind of a, hey, you're about to get messed up.
A lot of people are wondering whether Aunt May really is clueless or if she's like, she knows, but she's pretending she doesn't know because they have such a small apartment.
Aunt May doesn't know.
I don't think she knows.
It's only been 6 months since he got his powers.
Aunt May knows, I think. No, I don't think she does. He had that shit really well hidden up in the
So should we do a Aunt May doesn't know or Aunt May
Iron
knows?
Iron Man shows up in my apartment and talks to my teenage son.
Should we do a hashtag for that?
Yeah, Aunt May doesn't know.
Aunt May doesn't know.
I'm on Aunt May doesn't know.
We can't just call her Aunt May. Hot Aunt May.
No, we'll just go with Aunt May.
Because she's the hot Aunt May.
All right. It's Aunt May.
Aunt.
Okay. Aunt or Aunt?
Aunt and May.
Aunt is spelled A-N-T. Aunt is spelled A-U-N-T.
That depends on how you pronounce it. Depends on where you're from.
Now I'm picturing her in the Ant-Man suit.
There you go.
That's what I was going to say. Ant-Man May.
Wasp suit.
Yeah, they need to bring her back.
Well, they are. They're going to have an
Ant-Man
and Wasp.
They haven't announced an Ant-Man too. That's annoying.
Yes, they have.
Really?
It's going to be next year. Ant-Wasp. Right. Ant-Man and Wasp is the
All
next
I know is that Marvel has their act together and DC needs to catch up.
I was going
to
say, as you guys know from previous episodes, I was defensive of Batman v Superman, but I'm less defensive of it now because when I saw this movie and I walked away, I'm a DC fanboy with no apologies. However, and I think Wonder Woman is going to be awesome because it's not by Zack Snyder. But when I
watched now, didn't they just finish production?
They did. Yes. We'll switch subjects on that in just a second. But I want to wrap a little bit up on our Civil War discussion by saying that Marvel, when I walked away from Civil War, my feeling was, you know what? Why am I defending DC? They are not doing a good strategy. They trusted Zack Snyder, like we talked about, with two of the beginning movies to this entire legacy that they're trying to build, comparing it to Marvel. When you see Civil War, you walk away going, can they just keep getting better and better and better and better? You can't compare the two. Marvel owns the movies.
But I think that's what goes back to what I was saying earlier, that all the actors in the Marvel movies have so much experience with their characters.
And the producers,
that
the Russo
it just
brothers.
Keeps getting better because they get that much deeper into the characters.
Yep. Well, you look at Ultron. I mean, Ultron was a good movie except for the ending, which I didn't really like. I didn't really get the ending. They kind of lost the plot there. But again, they've had some flops. I mean, they're not real flops, but they have some that didn't really hit, like Hulk and so forth.
Final
and
thoughts.
And Iron Man 2.
Oh, go ahead,
so they have hit, you know, people that. But if they get good directors, which they have in the Russo brothers, and these writers who are going to be writing the Infinity War, the next two Avengers movies. And the Russo brothers are going to direct him. Those two are going to be smash hits. Those are going to knock them out of the park.
Final thoughts on before we move on to a couple other subjects before we wrap up the show. But anybody have any final thoughts about Civil War and the future of the Marvel movies?
I think they're going in the right place. I think Anthony, or you have said it right on. Anthony said they've got their shit together. I mean, they know what the hell they're doing. They've got their dominoes lined up. They don't respond to negative. Oh, people didn't like this or that. They just keep on plugging away. We got our next movie coming out. They didn't like this one. It's got another director, different writer. They just keep. The way that they set up their next movies are fully integrated into the movie itself. Whereas Batman trying to set up Wonder Woman and Aquaman, they're kind of just like plugged in there, right?
But they kind of did that with Civil War. They plugged Black Panther and Spider-Man.
But it worked.
That's the thing about this entire movie. This movie is the culmination of all of the continuity that came before.
And setting up future movies.
Fits.
Yeah.
Yes. It all fits. It's not just shoved Black Panther, in for the sake, hey, we need to build something. Let's shove this in there. This representation here and
they
hope people get it.
They didn't even give Black Panther a true explanation about where he gets his powers.
You don't have to.
You don't need it.
He's going to have his origin movie. He's
him
have his
and,
own movie.
And everybody knows Spider-Man's origin. And that was great how they just threw the two of them in there and they didn't have to do the whole exposition thing because...
didn't they even say, oh, yeah, I got my powers from... I don't care.
No,
all he said was
he's always been a Black Panther, and he sort of inherited it, but he didn't say where he got the powers.
No, I mean Spider-Man.
He said he is the protector of his country.
They've already said they're not going to have a new origin
well,
they for
might
Spider-Man.
Reference
everybody knows...
The...
No, they've already said they're not going to have a new origin for Spider-Man, because everybody knows how Spider-Man gets it.
He might mention...
That's not an origin movie.
That's what I was saying about when Tony and Peter were talking. He's like, yeah, I got my power from a... And then Tony just said, never mind.
Yeah,
let's just get right, because everybody knows it.
Everybody knows. Just like they didn't need to do that with... Well, they kind of did with Ben Affleck.
And if not, a quick Google search will answer the rest of your questions.
Exactly, right.
Yep. All right, so let's move on to... So we can squeeze in another couple of topics, because we actually have enough time to, if we really want to. Like Anthony mentioned, Wonder Woman just finished production. Now, here's the reason I'm excited about it, is because... It's not a Zack Snyder movie. And I think that, and Patty Jenkins, we've seen a preview of it from Kevin Smith and Jeff Johns did a little preview of the Wonder Woman movie. Just from what I've seen, it's a totally different tone from anything Zack Snyder's done. And a lot of people are excited. They think this could actually be the best DC movie that's ever come out. And a lot of people are saying that. I'm actually thinking that could be true.
Wait, ever?
Ever.
Even including like the
including
Michael
Dark
Keaton
Knight
Batman
and
the Dark Knight.
A lot of people
wow.
are saying this with credible opinions, but I mean,
I don't know. I like Michael Keaton as Batman.
But we're talking
that
about
would certainly be the boost that the DC needs.
Well, I'm gonna hold off until I actually see some footage. I haven't seen any footage yet.
Well, it's definitely gonna be the best of this new universe.
But as long as Zack Snyder is nowhere near it, I have high hopes.
Exactly.
Because Zack Snyder has not done very well with these two movies.
Right, but you do know that Zack Snyder is executive producing, or he's directing the Justice League.
Yeah, I was about to say
Justice League.
Yeah, Ben Affleck has been included in the production team and is taking over a lot of the creative responsibilities from Zack Snyder. He's gently being pushed out of the way. He's being kept in this in his contract. But Ben Affleck looks like he's starting to take a leadership role of Justice League and maybe, just maybe, DC series as a whole.
They did this with Wrath of Khan, Nicholas Meyer. When they first were making Star Trek II, The Wrath of Khan, Gene Roddenberry had a lot more say over the plot, and Paramount didn't like where he was going with this. So Nicholas Meyer, they gave him permission to kind of push Gene aside, so that he would still be he would save face and still be given credit. But Nicholas Meyer, when you hear the behind the scenes stories later at conventions, Nicholas Meyer ended up taking over the movie, and Gene had almost no say in what ended up happening that made the most awesome movie of the Star Trek franchise.
Right.
And this is what I think is starting to happen with this movie.
The thing with Ben Affleck is, I think everybody can agree. I personally liked his depiction. He's one of the better parts of that movie. His depiction of Batman and his depiction of, the millionaire, billionaire, whatever.
Bruce Wayne, right.
Bruce Wayne. So the way he separated those two characters, Bruce Wayne is, and the way, because you've seen the same thing with Gal Gadot when she did Wonder Woman. They have a facade that they, human facade, if you will, and then when they become the superhero, it's a completely different persona. And I like
somebody
that.
Once said that, I'll let you talk again, I just want to toss this in while I can remember it, and then you can go right back, Will. Someone once said, I think it was Ben Affleck, in fact, they said, the director creates the Batman, and the actor creates the Bruce Wayne.
I disagree. I think the actor just has a lot to do with how he portrays...
Well, no, because the director picks the tone, the costume.
You have Keaton as Batman and the Bruce Wayne. Val Kilmer was crap as both.
I liked him.
George Clooney
was okay.
I liked him too, except for the nipples.
He was not a good Batman. He was an okay Bruce Wayne, because he had.
Yeah, all right, I'll agree with you on that.
So, I think you've got to have, and that's why I think they've turned to Ben Affleck, because he's coming out of that movie. People liked him and said, look, and he's going to do his own Batman movie. He's got that going for him. I said, we'll just give him, like you said, with Nick Meyer. They're just giving it him to say, we need to push this guy.
Because they have a contract with Zack Snyder. Right. So they can't just kick him out without a problem and paying out a lot of money. So what they're doing is they're doing a trick where, and it's been done before, not just with Star Trek 2, I've heard it happen on other movies too, where if they want to overshadow a director that they think is not handling their movie well, they add someone and they give them the executive producer title, but they end up giving them more power and more say, and then that person kind of ends up really, Zack is still going to get credit, but Ben's going to end up really saying, unscrewing
George,
any.
Yeah, you've mentioned this before, where you're talking about how much was left on the cutting room floor for. They only had two shots, basically. The Russo brothers are so gifted and knowing what they want. They plan out all their shots. They very rarely shoot extra extemporaneous or other stuff that is not going to go in the movie. They only had two, basically, things that they were going to cut. Whereas Zack Snyder had an hour and a half of stuff he had to cut out of that damn movie.
What were you going to say, John?
Because he filmed it too long.
Just to support what he said, didn't the same thing happen for the Joss Whedon Avengers movies?
There might be
5 or 10 minutes, if that, of deleted scenes?
Yeah, and Joss Whedon's another good one. He just knows what he's doing and very little on the cutting room floor.
Anything directed by Peter Jackson.
Yes, true.
They have some good directors who are so good. Well, Peter Jackson, The Lord of the Rings, not Peter Jackson, The Hobbit. Because Peter Jackson, The Hobbit, when he came in, they didn't give him enough time to rework the script and set up. They just gave him this, and that's why The Hobbits are not that very good movies.
I actually like them, but yeah, I hear what you're saying. But yeah, I think that, So the bottom line is I'm excited about this Wonder Woman movie. A lot of people talked about Collider News when they broke the Wonder Woman news. They talked about, because I'm not going to give myself the credit for this opinion, but I agree with them. So I'm going to just agree with what they said, because I hadn't thought about it until they mentioned it. So I'm not going to give myself the credit. They talked about how when you see that scene where Wonder Woman's looking at that picture with Chris Pine and the past, you want to know so much more just from that scene. That it makes this next movie so much more interesting, because it's almost like they set it up. You know, you want to know what happened. What is she remembering when she's looking at that picture about the adventures that she went through with these guys? You know what I mean? And we're about to see that.
The one thing I would have a little trepidation over is Marvel's already done this with Captain America. You know,
but they didn't set it up with the picture.
No, but it doesn't. The setting up is irrelevant, George. It's done in the past. They're going to have a World War II or a World War I in the past movie. Now, again, they maybe do completely different. Again, DC being a little different than Marvel, maybe a little more.
Well, she didn't sleep through her whole.
You know, right.
Yeah, that's the big difference between Wonder Woman and Captain America.
I agree. But the thing is, it's going to be in the past, right? It's not. Yeah. She's not going to be jumping around between times. It's going to be in the past. It's
right.
Going to be a period piece, just like Winter Soldier was.
And I, well, you mean like the first
and there's
Avenger.
Nothing wrong with that.
First Avengers. No, there's nothing wrong with it. I'm just a little trepidation because people have already seen that with Captain America.
No, they haven't. This is that's why they picked World War I when normally she's been in World War II. They wanted it to be a little bit different.
But George, people are not going to be that. Oh, it's World War I versus World War II. It's in the past.
There is a difference, though.
It's not really.
The ideas are: do they want a superhero in a war movie again?
She said to Batman in the end of Batman v Superman how she saw the horrors that we did back then. So we're going to see how she's looking at the world, how she talked about why she gave up on us.
Right. So we're going to get a lot of her backstory.
She gave up on us because of what she saw happen in World War One.
She's going to get a lot of her in her kingdom, wherever she is. She comes into our world, meets the you know, her love or whatever, fights with him, and then he dies or whatever.
Do you know what? You know what, though? You know who that Indian guy is? It was revealed that he's actually another DC hero, Apache Chief, who was only in the Super Friends cartoon. That's a little
Apache
trivia.
Apache Chief, nay, Chuck.
That's who this guy is. He's Apache Chief. They talked about that in an interview. Like, they decided that he's Apache Chief. And he was like, you know how Harley Quinn first came out in the animated series and then she went to the comics because she was so popular? Well, this is what they did with Apache Chief. He was originally a original Super Friends character. He was never in the comics. Apache Chief! And they brought in, they decided this is who this guy is. I would be cool if they brought in Sergeant Rock and his group, and if they do a sequel in World War II or a little few years later. That'd be cool. Have, like, The Rock play Sergeant Rock. That'd be awesome. Oh, my God. You see what I did there? And I didn't even
mean to. Very good, yeah.
That was an accident.
He's a poet, and he didn't know it.
Exactly. So I'm excited for the Wonder Woman movie. That's going to be awesome. And Suicide Squad looks awesome. We never talked about that on this show. I keep forgetting, and I think it looks awesome. I think it's a totally different tone. And the thing is with these two movies, they have one thing in common. They're not Zack Snyder. So I think they're both going to have their own.
Yeah, but with the Suicide Squad, and this is again talking about DC responding. As soon as Batman Superman came out and it was not getting the reviews, what are we next thing we hear? Suicide Squad's in some reshoots.
Yeah, but
millions of dollars on reshoots.
That doesn't
reshoots
mean we have
aren't
to panic.
Uncommon among films.
They're not.
Though. They
Marvel
happen
does
all,
it
the
all the
time.
Marvel
right,
does it
but
all the time.
I don't know how much money they're going to be spending on reshoots and how many they're doing.
But we don't know why.
And why are these people? Why are the reporters reporting on it if it's just common?
It can't be because of the thing about how everybody's complaining how there was no humor and nothing but a dark tone. Because obviously, from the trailers before they announced this,
right,
Suicide Squad's already.
What they were reporting was they put all of the humor into the trailer. There was nothing left for the movie.
I don't think that's true.
I don't know. That's the thing.
I think they might have come up with a better. Maybe they're reshooting because they want to add something that spins off, like a hint from another character or something
maybe.
Like that.
Oh, do you think they're adding more Batman footage?
Could be
Batman.
Ben
Affleck.
That would make could sense. Be. It could be a Batman thing, or they could even be giving a hint to Justice League, throwing something in. Because here's the difference, okay? Suicide Squad is supposed to take place before, according to what I read, before Batman v Superman, the events of that movie. So in timeline purposes, when this movie comes out, they haven't seen Batman v Superman fight each other. None of that's happened yet. Wonder Woman obviously takes place way in the past.
The trailer that I saw for Suicide Squad had a scene of a bunch of like military guys, and someone says, well, what if Superman ripped off the White House and did something to the president?
There was a 2-year gap between Man of Steel and Batman
there
and Superman.
There was, okay.
So
all
this
right.
is supposed to take place just before
between
Batman
them.
V Superman.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
Which is another thing I don't like with DC. They don't have their timelines right. Why isn't Suicide Squad before Batman and Superman?
I don't know.
You'd have to ask
all I know is this.
Exactly. The people in charge of planning then.
All I know is this. Anne Hathaway thought that she was auditioning for Harley Quinn.
Oh,
come
really?
To find out it was, you know. Batman.
I hated the Nolan movie, except for the first one, so I don't really care. Oh, no, I'm sorry. I take it back. I did love the second one only because of the Joker there. Other than that, it wasn't. I mean, the third one was just. I hated it.
No,
the Dark Knight Rises. One? Yeah, the Dark Knight Rises.
The thing about that movie is, it was fine on its own, but I didn't get why. You know, he broke his back, then he sent him to some place in Africa or some other country, and he had to break out of there.
No, he was actually in Gotham or right outside. He was underground.
No, it was.
Will, everybody knows that if you break your back, you have to go to Africa.
Yeah, that's true.
But the thing is, he's in a hole on the bottom, and he had to climb up. And I'm like, this whole time, these people have been running around for a year in Gotham, you know, threatening, and all these people are running around. Where are they getting the food? I mean, everything's shut down. People are not letting anything in.
They don't eat in
Africa.
They don't
eat. Well,
no, this is in Gotham.
They're eating poo-poo.
Okay, and what about all the police officers that were stuck underground the whole time?
Right!
Did they even get a change of clothing?
Yeah, and
And then when they break them out, all of a sudden they're ready to go and they're a fighting force. They've been stuck underground for a year.
Right.
How the hell are you going to be able to shoot a gun and be able to kill people straight out of the bat? You got to take a couple of weeks to, you know, reset your body.
All right, I do want to drop one more, or at least one or two more subjects before we wrap up today, because I do have to go soon, but there's news that broke out. I wanted to talk about the newest Flash episode, but I think I'm going to wait till next week so we can talk about this episode and the next one in one show, unless something major breaks out for news. But I do want to mention that Sci-Fi Channel announced they're releasing a prequel, which sounds kind of stupid, actually. I don't think I'm going to watch it. It's called Krypton. What do you guys think about this?
Right, I've heard the title, but I haven't seen anything about it.
I don't
yet.
Care about Krypton. I only care about Superman on Earth.
The only way this show would interest me, and I'm going to throw this out there, they don't have to go to, because they would kind of screw up the canon if they go to Earth and have somebody learn that they can, under a yellow sun, do their powers, right? But what if part of this, like season two or whatever, they discover another yellow sun world and they suddenly realize they can be gods and on this world, and some of the characters do the Superman stuff as they discover their...
George, they already knew what the yellow sun would do. It's just like when the original Superman back in 1977, when the mom said to her husband, he will be able to fly. He'll be able to do all this because of the yellow sun. They already knew that.
No, not all of them.
I'm talking about the original Superman movie.
But not the whole world. Only certain groups, like the Els, which were the scientists, they knew because they had explored Earth before. Same on Smallville. But no, the other cast didn't know. Because if they had, they would have gone off and conquered those worlds. But
I'm actually interested. I'm curious to see what they're going to do with it. What kind of story they'll do going forward.
But I have to agree with Anthony, because in Man of Steel, when they were sending, getting ready to launch that ship, that pretty much, I think they said he's going to be a god among men.
Yeah,
they know what Yellow Sun does to him. They know what it'll do to him.
The bad guys didn't know. They were discovering this when they got there. Only the Jor-El knew. It was like it's like he's the scientist cast. Remember they had the warrior cast, the scientist cast, because they were genetically predisposed, like a socialist society. Jor-El had known about Earth and what would happen if a Kryptonian goes there.
They're not the warriors. So they're not going to go around.
So that's what I'm saying.
People.
In the TV show, what would interest me is if they find a different world besides Earth.
Well,
that has
criminals
the
don't care about science. They just want to rob and steal stuff. So they're not going to sit there and say,
the
yellow sun is going to make us great. Let's go there and kill
they
people.
Were
it's called Krypton. It's going to take place on Krypton.
On Krypton,
yes.
Right.
Does it mean they can't explore other worlds?
No, it's going to be about Krypton. It's going to be about their society. That's the whole purpose
The things I've read about it so far, it's going to be a Kryptonian game. Game of Thrones, and I'm okay with that.
Superman's grandpa.
I'm cool with that. I want to see
Sci-fi
people
Game
die.
Right, exactly. If that's what it is,
I want Sansa Stark to go out there and destroy people.
That would be interesting. Where people are dying left and right. Yes.
All right. I will monitor progress. I haven't been a fan of like 99% of what Sci-Fi does.
Will they have a midget on this show? I drink and I know things.
Can you imagine a Kryptonian midget with Superman's powers later on? That would be awesome. Be like Krypton.
Right, have we talked about Super Dog?
Speaking of superheroes, I mean super from Krypton, have we talked about Supergirl moving to CW maybe?
We can drop that real quick.
Is that final though? I thought they were no, just no, they're still, talking about it.
They're in discussions.
No, they're still talking about it. There's been some debate, and I think Anthony mentioned this in a chat thing. The problem if they do that is if it becomes CW, they film in Canada, and Calista Flockhart will likely not move from LA to Canada to keep filming.
Right, I heard that.
So
it should be expensive anyways. Get rid of her. Get rid of her contract, and then you save millions of dollars on that.
I don't think they're gonna do it. What I think.
Well, what
happen,
they'll do is, if that's the case, they will cancel the show,
but keep her,
and then
character.
Recast.
Or they will bring her over to the CW by herself to be Power Girl, or have her come over to Earth One or whatever to have her come in once in a while. You know,
no, the only expensive person on that show is Calista Flockhart.
Right, right, right.
So they will cancel the show, which cancels her contract, and then move everybody else who doesn't cost that much to Canada.
Well, they don't have to cancel. They can let her out of the contract if she refuses to move.
They will cancel the show, which cancels her contract.
All right.
And then
well,
just how do they go? We go. Oh, we're rebuilding or how would they recast our?
They're gonna rebrand it.
So they can't call it Supergirl,
yeah. No, they'll call it Supergirl. They'll just rebrand it. Yeah, I don't know.
I think there's a lot of clever ways. The CW has proven one thing: they are very clever, and I think they'll find a way if they really want to do it.
I think they should. Supergirl deserves a second season.
Well, Kevin Smith even said they are incredibly interested in continuing.
I don't recognize Kevin Smith's authority.
I do.
Yeah, wait a minute. Is Kevin Smith a producer or
no,
a director?
No, he directed.
No, he doesn't do anything. So
wait, when
he did The Flash. The only reason why Jason Mewes was in The Flash is because of Kevin Smith.
But they respect the hell out of him, and they wanted him to direct that.
Thus is
episode.
Kevin Smith's right. Do not deny Kevin Smith.
Yeah, Kevin exactly,
Smith.
Right?
Kevin Smith has a lot of influence. Come on.
Kevin Smith, he weighs a metric ton.
He had not. He was, there you go. That's why he calls his own podcast Fat Man on Batman. He knows. Anyways.
Yeah, but I'm
all
talking
right, guys.
About the Austin Powers Fat
Man. I thought this was a great discussion today. I have to get going.
Me too.
But that was great. We'll talk about next week. No matter what news pops up, I do want to mention we'll have at least two new episodes of The Flash discussed, because there's so much to talk about with that. It was awesome this week, and I'm sure next week's is going to be awesome because it looks great. But guys, I want to thank you for joining me. The whole Civil War discussion was great. Any final thoughts from anybody?
I'm actually looking forward to the new Spider-Man movie.
I do want to mention, I don't remember, Ross, did we talk about the new podcast thing earlier? No, I didn't. So
not
I'm going to mention this real quick, just to drop it, because it's not final, we're still working on it. Ross and I and a few other people have this idea for a new podcast. It would be like June or July before it's even really conceived. But there's a trend going on out there where people are role-playing, like tabletop, D&D, or some other game, and they're just basically doing podcasts where they're playing it out, and the other hosts have made characters, and they're using either they're doing it video-wise where they're rolling the dice in the room with each other, or they're using a virtual dice so that they can basically tell an adventure, have people run through the adventures. And we're thinking of doing that in a format that we're still working out, but the working title is, and there's a personal reason why I want to call it this, is Want to Get a Game Going? Because I used to have a friend offline who used to every day come knocking on my door, hey guys, want to get a game going? So I play D&D for like 20 years. John, I know you used to play D&D. I don't know about the rest of you, but I think it'll be fun. We're going to figure out the format and we're going to get that going, but I'm very passionate about this idea that it can make a great podcast, because you're basically running a tabletop style game and you're recording the adventure as a podcast, and you're hearing what's going on. I think it'll be fun as hell, and it'll probably be bi-weekly, because you know it's going to be tough to make it a weekly thing and have everybody be able to be there. So, but look forward to that, and there's some other news that we're going to announce as soon as Ross and I get some more details. But I want to thank you guys for joining us.
All
right.
I got one last thing.
Go ahead.
So I've probably mentioned on the podcast Rooster Teeth before, right?
Yes.
So they launched a Kickstarter for
Wait,
a
who?
Game, a card game. Rooster Teeth?
I don't remember you talking about them.
Red versus Blue?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Okay.
They've launched a Kickstarter for a card game that is Cards Against Humanity-ish. It's Have you ever had one, George, you probably know about the familiar with this. Have you ever played the game where you're bored off your mind, so you ask your buddy, hey, would you do this if you could, if you they gave you $1 million? Something outlandish or ridiculous or gross?
Yeah.
Sounds like scenario time on Classic so too.
It's a card game. $1 million, but.
Is it like the one where Demi Moore sleeps with the dude for $1 million? I forget.
Okay, so for an example, $1 million, but every time you hear a phone ring, you have to eat a sponge.
Okay, so, and they're making a game?
A card game.
Where you eat sponges?
No, you have a condition, $1 million, but every time the second card is, you have to do this.
What's
the
URL?
Person with
the
most ridiculous scenario rent.
I'll post the URL for that Kickstarter on this on when we upload this. But what's the site for it?
MDBgame.com.
Yeah, it sounds semi interesting. I'd have to get more details.
I contributed to it, and I want to get the word out.
All right. Well, I'll check it out at least. I'm not sure if I would eat a sponge even if I drew that card. But
is this sponge worthy?
Is it sponge-worthy, Ross, sorry.
It's ShamWow-worthy.
Oh! Hey, that guy died, so. Just saying.
The salesman okay. died, not, jeez.
Yeah, I know, but I'm just saying.
Anyway, yep, I have to get going
yeah.
as well.
I want to thank everyone for joining us. It was a great show. I think this is actually one of our better
us.
Ones. And we'll talk to you guys next time.
Okay, talk to you later. Hey, bye.